What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Before kicking off the video, I want to mention that if you haven't watched the abstract data types versus data structures video, I suggest you do that, and then proceed with this one, because today we are going to explain what queues are, what are the different operations offered by queues, and then we are going to try and implement these different operations. So let's get to it. Okay, so queues are abstract data types and can be implemented using arrays or linked lists, similarly to the list abstract data type. But what defines a queue, what makes this abstract data type different than the others, is that it follows the first-in, first-out structure, aka the FIFO structure, which means that the first item we insert onto the queue is the first item we remove. As a real-life example, take any waiting queue, like at the cinema or a vending machine or a parking machine. When 10 or 20 people are waiting in line for their turn, the first person to come in is the first one to be served, even if the first person's request requires an hour to process, and the next one needs only a couple of seconds. Well, the next one has to wait, because the first person was there before him. As simple as that. And that is exactly what happens with queues, and what a FIFO structure means. If an element is inserted or enqueued into the queue before another element, when we try to serve or dequeue an item from this specific queue, the item that was placed before is the item that will be served. You see, a queue is just a list, but instead of having the add, remove, and get operations, we have the enqueue, dequeue, and peak operations. The enqueue operation will add an item to the next available slot or back of the queue, or what we call tail of the queue. The dequeue operation will remove an item from the front of the queue, or what we call the head of the queue. And the peak operation will return to you the head of the queue. Because think about it, if you were the one serving these people who are waiting in line, all you can see, all you have access to, is this first guy standing in front of you waiting for his request to be processed. Only when this guy's request is done, the one after him will approach you and reveal to you what he needs. So all you could have access to is the head of the queue, and that's what the peak operation is providing you with. Queues have many applications in real life, as well as in computer science, where they can perform the function of a buffer when data is transferred asynchronously. It is also massively used in CPU task scheduling, and also in the implementation of several algorithms like breadth-first search, which we will be discussing in a future video, by the way. Now, after this brief introduction, let's try to implement the enqueue, dequeue, and peak operations of the queue abstract data type using the array and linked list data structures. First, using arrays. In this case, our queue will be an array, of course, and as usual, we will try to make it as generic as possible. If you are not familiar with generics, we do have a video that covers all you need to know about them, so make sure to check it. Our head and tail will be represented by indices, so they will have int as their type. And you can also see two additional fields, size and capacity. The size represents how many elements we actually have inside the array or the queue, and the capacity is how many elements this queue can hold at maximum. This number will be passed while instantiating the queue, as you can see in the constructor, and would be fixed just like an actual array. You could go ahead and make this a resizable array, just like we did while implementing stacks using arrays, but I am going to keep it simple, so you can take a look at both approaches and focus on the queue operations. Concerning the constructor, as you can see, the size is initialized at 0, obviously, the head at 0, and the tail at -1. Do not worry, these numbers will make much more sense when we start filling the enqueue and dequeue operations. So let's start with the enqueue method. Before enqueuing the given item, we have to check if the array or queue we have is full, right? And if that is the case, well, we can't insert anything into the queue. So we will have to inform the user about that and return or exit from the method. Checking if the queue is full or not is pretty straightforward. The queue becomes full when its size is equal to its capacity. Remember, its size is the number of elements it actually contains, and its capacity is the maximum number of elements it can hold, which is the number passed to the constructor by the user that instantiated the queue. Now, if the queue is not full, we know that it can hold more elements, so we have to insert the data item passed to the enqueue method in the array. We previously mentioned that when inserting into a queue, we insert in the back or tail of the queue. Always remember the people standing in line. When a new person comes, they stand in the back. So we have to insert in the tail. And because we inserted, we also have to increment the size of the queue to keep track of the items we have. In code, that is setting the queue element at position tail to be equal to data, and then incrementing the size of the queue. However, you may have noticed that there is a problem with our implementation as it is right now. Actually, two problems. The first one is that we initialized our tail to be minus 1 in the constructor, if you recall. So, we are trying to insert an item at position minus 1, and that will throw an index out of bounds exception. The second is that we are always inserting or enqueuing our data in the same position. Our tail is not changing. So, if we try to insert a second item without dequeuing the first one, the item we are going to insert is going to override the one we have, if we keep our code as is. To solve these problems, we have to increase our tail before enqueuing the element. So, tail equals tail plus 1. This way, the first element we insert will get inserted at index 0, and the second one at index 1, and so on. However, when we reach the end of the queue, we will have another problem. Suppose that our array can hold 5 items. If the tail keeps increasing and reaches index 4, when we try to enqueue a new element, it will try to enqueue it at position or index 5, which doesn't exist, because our max index is 4, and this will also throw an index out of bounds exception. This can be solved using the modulo operator. You see, in this example, 5 modulo 5 is 0, so our method will insert the item at index 0, hence creating a circular-like queue. Now, you may ask, but aren't we overriding the item at position 0 like that? Well, no, because we apply the whole modulo thing after checking if the queue is full, and we only do the following operation if the size is different than our capacity. This check prevents us from overriding any data. I know I went a bit slow with the enqueue operation, but that is because the dequeue one is actually pretty similar to it. Therefore, in the case of dequeuing, instead of checking if the array is full, we have to check if it is empty. Well, if we have something in there to dequeue. And if indeed the queue is empty, we have to inform the user and return from the method. To check if the queue is empty, we can check if the size is equal to 0. As simple as that. Now, because the dequeue operation returns the data we dequeued, we have to store the data we want to remove in a variable to be able to do that. And of course, the data we are removing is always found at the head of the queue. The same way we increased the tail in case of the enqueue operation, we have to increase the head in case of the dequeue operation. Remember, we served the current head and therefore have to move on to the next item in the queue, and that is the head plus 1 item. Of course, the modulo operator is here to keep a circular-like queue active and avoid exceptions. After increasing the head, we have to decrease the size because, well, we just removed an item and we need to keep track of the number of elements inside the queue. The last operation, and the easiest by far, is the peak operation, which returns the element at the head of the queue. Let's go ahead now and try to implement the queue abstract data type using the linked list data structure. As always, because we are using linked lists, we have to create a node for this list, or in our case, the queue. The data stored inside the queue will be wrapped inside a node, so this node will consist of our data and a reference to our next node in the queue. The addData annotation you can see will generate getters, setters, a toString method, and a constructor for us. This is a Lombok annotation. And if you have no idea what that is, as always, there is a video here on Geekific that covers everything about Lombok. Do not hesitate to check it. Next is our queue class. Same as the array, we are trying to make it as generic as possible. We will have two nodes this time, one representing our head and another our tail. And, in addition to this, of course, an integer to keep track of the size of our queue. In the constructor, you can initialize both the head and the tail to null, or you can choose to keep it empty. That is totally optional because by default they are assigned the null value. Concerning the enqueue operation, we always start by wrapping the given data with a node. Then we have to consider two options, if the queue is empty or if it isn't. After doing this, we have to increase the size as we did for the array implementation version to keep track of the elements in the queue. The isEmpty operation can be implemented exactly as before by checking if the size is equal to 0. Now, if the queue is empty, then the node we just created is the first node we are inserting or enqueuing. Hence, this node will be the head as well as the tail of our queue. In code, this can be written as heads equals tails equal the node. However, if the node we created isn't the first one, then we have to treat it as if we are inserting a new item into a linked list, and the root of that linked list is the head of our queue. So the next node of our tail, currently equal to null, is where we will have to insert this new node. We will have to set the next node of our current tail to be the newly created node. After doing that, we update our tail to be the same node as it is now the last item of the queue. This isn't the same as inserting an item into a single linked list, because in a linked list, we insert new items at the root or the head of the list, but here we need to insert at the back or tail of our queue. Concerning the dequeue operation, we also have to check if the queue is empty. If that is the case, then we return null, as there is nothing to dequeue. However, if the queue does contain a few elements, then as we did in the case of the array implementation, we have to save the element we are removing in a variable, because we will need to return it. After doing this, we set the head to be the next node of the current head. If you think about it, it is kind of similar to increasing the index of the head by 1 in case of an array, or just serving the next node or item in the queue. Then, of course, don't forget to decrement the size of the queue by 1. Finally, the peak method. It is also straightforward. However, in this case, we can't simply return the data stored inside the head node. We have to first make sure that the queue is not empty. Because if it is, then the head.getData call will throw a null pointer exception. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you on the next one.